They did this to you! They're trying to turn us against each other! Just look at them. What do they know about friendship anyway? I'll get them. You watch. I'll take care of those sons of bitches.
Watch it, Alan. I'm shooting.
Oh, good Lord. It's unbelievable. It's horrible. I can't understand the reason for such cruelty. It must have something to do with some obscure sexual rite or with the almost profound respect these women.
Getting very careless. Blood in your hair. What will we do? You want to look pretty, don't you? Pretty for me.
I can't believe you're not afraid.
All you have to do is piss on it.
Goody cat blood, ain't you?
God damn it, Ralph, get out of here. Go on, get. Leave people alone.
You'll never come back again.
Oh, shut up, Ralph.
It's got a death curse.
Evil.
God, my leg. God, my leg.
I'm here. You're here.
There's a fog bank out there.
Messenger of God. You're doomed if you stay here.
Demanding everything, including blood.
John, I want this material burned. All of it.
The one who attacked me, the one who pulled me underneath the water. Then he's still there.
Used servitude.
I think you will all meet again. In hell!
I'd have mercy on his soul. He was one ruthless son of a bitch.
Wendy.
Sally!
Darling, light of my life. I'm not gonna hurt you. You didn't let me finish my sentence. I said, I'm not gonna hurt you. I'm just gonna bash your brains. I'm gonna bash them right the fuck.
Well, Dad, are you proud of me now? Do I measure up? Huh?
My son was a son of a bitch, and he was no good. That's it. My son is dead. I don't want to talk about him no more.
Oh, see me. You're gonna die.
We didn't find any boy.
Mater Superiorum.
You know as well as I do, it takes all kinds of critters
to make farmer mints and fritters.
I wonder who the real cannibals are.
All right, guys, we're here for this is my final recording of kind of the special 1980 in-depth looks at certain movies, and I brought along Dave Zee. Now, Dave Zee is a podcaster. You've been doing this for like 10 years. You started on like the Skeleton Crew, ABCs of Hidden Horror, and then, of course, the Exploding Heads Horror Movie Podcast, which is on Patreon only. So check it out. It's also on YouTube. But yeah, he's been doing this forever. And when I thought The Shining, because I already covered The Shining, I wanted to have a special guest come in. I thought, who likes The Shining better than almost anyone? And I figured Dave Zee. I've heard him profess his love for it. And of course, everyone knows or loves The Shining or respects it, except my co-host on my show, who seems to not like The Shining, or Stephen King. I don't know what's going on there. But yeah, so Dave Zee is here to talk about The Shining. How's it going, Dave?
Awesome, man. Thanks for having me. I'm glad to do it. And hi, everybody out there in YouTube land, because I'm not on YouTube very much. Yeah. I know this guy's Mr. YouTube, so yeah. It's cool to be here. Wait, who doesn't like The Shining? What co-host? Are you
Jeremy.
Talking about...
On my show, we do that. He hates Stephen King, and I made him watch The Shining. Was the only Stephen King. Matt and Carrie, the only ones he watched. And he's just like, I told you, I don't want to watch The fucking Shining. I just don't get it, because he likes Stanley Kubrick movies too.
Wow, that's because it's more of a Kubrick vehicle than Stephen King.
It's nothing like Stephen King, which makes you think that it's the opposite of Stephen King. So you think you'd like it because King hates it, but you know, I don't know. I guess he just doesn't like the story in general. boy, where do we start with The Shining? You know, originally when this movie came out, it was kind of panned, you know, it was, the reviews were divided, similar to The Thing. It wasn't that beloved. And it's funny that two of the icy kind of cold horror movies of all time were kind of panned. And now they're two of the most beloved, probably top five favorite horror movies among hardcore horror fans. Not, you know, we talk like mainstream, it would be obviously like Alien and Halloween. But we start getting into like the nitty gritty. Most people are going to say something like The Thing or The Shining or something along those lines. So, yeah,
definitely The Thing. It seems like The Thing is like the most universally loved because it doesn't have that. Like The Shining is the kind of movie that some people could be bored by, or they think that it's too, like, I don't know, too long. There's certain like things in The Shining that it doesn't have the easy access that like The Thing has. The Thing, I don't think I know any horror fan that doesn't like The Thing, but I damn well know I know some people that don't like The Shining besides your co-host, you know.
Well, The Shining's it's like a mood piece too. Like, you kind of almost have to be in a certain mood. Like, I'll never dislike it, but I'll have better experiences with it sometimes, you know, because it's just like you get zoned in, especially if you start like somewhat connecting with the characters at all.
Which I do every time I watch. I've connected with the characters since I was a kid when I saw it. And like, to me, I mean, I get this certain joy out of certain characters. It doesn't happen much when you have like an antagonist that's a real bastard. But for some reason, I find myself laughing along with some of the stuff that comes out of Jack's mouth throughout the movie. And I know a lot of people probably don't, but I like, even the performance is so great, but I also enjoy just that type of asshole. But he's a total bad guy, but there's just something about him where this doesn't sound good, but I'm always open. There's a small part of me sometimes with some of the things that he says that I wish I could say.
Well, it's also Jack fucking Nicholson, who's got so much screen presence. And I mean, like, this is one thing. He's a movie star. So Jack Nicholson is, there's a little bit of Jack Nicholson in every performance he plays. And he demands a screen. Every performance I've ever seen him in, he's made decent movies great. Like, just by his performance. Like, we were talking about Wolf in 94, and like, he makes that fucking movie. Like, it's a great, it's a solid ass movie, but he really pushes it further. And tell me if it was not him as R.P. McMurphy in One for the Cuckoo's Nest. That's like one of the best movies ever made, and his performance is at the heart and soul of that.
Oh, man. Absolutely. He is the man. And like, to me, this is my favorite role of his. This is my favorite performance of anybody in a horror movie, period. So I'm zoned in right from the beginning. And, you know, speaking of the beginning, you notice that a lot of people that don't like the movie, especially people that like the book, they're always quick to say, I don't like the fact, and King himself has said this, I don't like the fact that because it's Jack Nicholson, you're already expecting some type of crazy out of him, and he's already crazy from the start, where in the novel, you know, the pieces slowly unravel and he cracks up. But I will say this, this is my rebuttal every time. The minute we see Jack Nicholson in this movie, he's already in the hotel. The first time we meet him, he's already set foot in the Overlook. So take is, he's already been touched a little bit.
Well, same thing with like Session 9, right? Like, Gordy would have probably never done that. And you can compare these, they're very similar movies. And like, I think Session 9 is more of just a place, like, that had a lot of suffering. And maybe nothing supernatural, but just the suffering alone and knowing it was there has enough effect on his psyche because he was already pushed to the edge. And you know what I think personally? I think that we know that Stephen King's most personal book was like The Shining, right? So he put himself a lot in the Jack Nicholson, the alcoholism, maybe the possible child abuse. So when he saw that Stanley Kubrick looked at face value and was like, he's just a drunk, kind of a loser, and he just didn't treat him and didn't give him that redeeming quality at the end, it hurt Stephen King to a point where he was upset about it. But you don't have Stanley Kubrick, the cold clinical director, make a movie about a redeeming character. If you look at A Clockwork Orange or even 2001, Dr. Strangelove, his movies are cold and clinical and they can be very funny, but at the same time, they're never really heartwarming.
No, that's true.
There's no redemption in The Shining for Jack Nicholson.
No, but the thing is, that's one of the things I love about it. I imagine if it had the original ending in a movie like this, it would almost seem like a cop-out. just to have all of a sudden he swerves and he stops the place from blowing up that he was once going to blow up. And then it ends the way it ends in the book. I couldn't imagine that happening in this particular film.
Not the way this unfolds. Not the way it unfolds, because the way he's handled, like, he's just so much darker in the movie than he is in the book, I think. And Nicholson is crazy. He's crazy from the, he's off. But when you see this movie, you know, like, he's going to be off the entire time. So it has a disadvantage already, because most people read the book and, like, so why not cast fucking Jack Nicholson? They already know he's going to snap.
Right. He's, like, great at it.
Fuck it. And,
right.
Yeah, and Shelley Duvall in this movie, like, I actually think her performance is on par with Jack Nicholson. I'd say one of the most uncomfortable scenes of all of 1980 is when she's telling that, is it a psychiatrist or whoever it is? And she's saying,
yeah, the doctor,
it was just a freak accident. And there's, like, she has that cigarette and it's just like, it's so uncomfortable.
Yeah.
It's so awful and just so real. So real.
Totally. You could tell that she is, you could almost even hear his words coming out of her mouth when she says, purely an accident. It sounds like the way
Jack
delivers a line, like when, even like later on when he's talking to Grady. I've always picked up on little things like that. And you can see that the woman's just looking at her and she's probably thinking, yeah, you guys are both victims here, I think. You know what I mean?
You need to get out of this right away. And everybody else can see it but you. And you notice that Jack Nicholson brings it up later to the bartender. What the fuck's the bartender's name? You'll know.
Lloyd.
And he says a different story. It's not the same. And that happens a lot in this movie. People repeat shit and nothing ever matches up. So you don't know who's lying or who's not remembering or if they're getting fucked with. So the movie is filled with confusion. Like, you don't even really know exactly how the hotel works or what's what. Is it a ghost story? Is it a possession story? Is it The Shining that's causing it? Who the fuck knows? Is it just a combination, amalgamation of it, which caused this? So some people hate that. They want a clear-cut answer. I don't mind. I think it's vastly interesting. I don't like is when we start getting on these off-the-wall conspiracy theories, like that documentary. And the Room 2-3, that guy, he just gets people that I feel have mental illness and gets them to talk. And like his same documentary about the sleep disorder, I felt was the same. And I turned both his movies off in a half an hour. I was just like, you might as well just, go to a circus and film people with like mental problems. That's what I felt like I was watching, just like some guy exploiting people and just saying off the wall shit.
Wow. You know, I saw Room 237 one time when it dropped on Netflix, and I saw it, and I was going to say something because I did watch the whole thing and there was like four or five different theories. And I know everybody wants to discredit everything that is said in that movie.
Not everything.
Well, this is kind of what I took from it. I don't know Stanley Kubrick from another director. These people seem to be like really into Kubrick. Yeah. And they said, well, Kubrick was known for this and he was known for that. I didn't have that knowledge prior to that. And matter of fact, up until a few years ago, the only Kubrick movies I had ever seen were The Shining and Full Metal Jacket. But Full Metal Jacket just didn't seem like the rest of Kubrick's movies. So it didn't even really register. But when they were talking about Kubrick and all these theories and this and that, ever since I saw that documentary, and I'm not saying I believe in one or the other, but one more added thing to this movie is that when I watch it, I do notice that I'll look around at the background and I'll look at certain things and I'll see if there's any validity to anything, some of these theories that are out there. And I want to say that maybe some of those theories do hold water. I don't know. It does make me think a little bit.
Yeah, some of them for sure. Like the Native American aspect, I don't disagree with, because that's in there. And that was a very big trope of the horror movie times. Like, there's a lot of tropes in here and stuff. But again, going back to Stephen King, who's like, this movie was terrible, yada, yada, yada. Do you remember like the movie he directed? Which I love, but I mean, like, it's no Shining. And also he released, there's this list that floats around the internet all the time. And it's like Stephen King's top favorite horror movies from the last 20 years. And he has like Dawn of the Dead remake over the original on there. And just like straight shit, like not that Dawn of the remake's bad, but it's just not a top quality movie. It's never, ever going to be anyone's favorite list. Not seriously, not.
No.
And especially someone Stephen King's age, which shows, I guess, he has a younger heart. But looking at the list, you're just like, what the fuck is this? I'm sorry, this is not a good list to me. But that's just me. I don't even know where to go next. We compared him. You said he's likable, like to a certain extent. You love watching Stephen King, right? I mean, like Jack Nicholson.
Right.
Very quotable, but there is a relatable quality to him. the high stress, the possibly, you know, like, I shouldn't say this, but everybody's had their dad look at them at one point when he's clearly stressed and losing, and he just wants to kill you. And there is some truth about, you know, the family annihilators that kill their entire families, right?
Yeah, of course.
And he obviously had some resentment towards Wendy, and she should have had resentment towards him.
I mean, yeah, we don't know the story, though. I mean, you're just picking up. I mean, there's so many different ways to look at it. Like, it seems like sometimes he is a nice guy, and sometimes it even seems like their relationship isn't too bad. But the way they communicate, like, because she's pretty much shocked when she comes in that one scene and he gives her that speech. He goes, "You're distracting me," and that whole thing.
Yeah, yeah.
The look on her face, if she was a regular abuse victim, because she comes in all, "Hey, hon, how's everything go?" If she was used to being abused that way, it really wouldn't faze her.
Yeah.
But she shows like genuine shock, the look on her face that he's acting this way. I'm not defending him.
No, I'm just saying
that I think that there may be some good in this relationship, like in a lot of relationships. And maybe he does have some issues with the drinking and it's caused them. And like they said, after he did that thing with Danny, which, you know, he pulled his arm, he quit drinking. So maybe there's an effort being made. But now we see that he's in a desperate situation and he has to go and get this job done. And if he fucks this job up, what's going to happen to him? Right. So I think this is what the stress of that. But the thing is, the relationship with them, it just seems to me that there's a couple moments that they seem okay. So I don't know. I just think that there's something like underneath the surface stress wise. And of course he did what he did to Danny, you know, at that time, but the way she reacts to it doesn't show me that she's a victim of habitual abuse. I could be reading too deep into it. I don't know, but
I think there was a past abuse, but he's been good for a while now. So when it relapses, right, you know, she never expects it. But, you know, what's your favorite line in the movie? I know my favorite line in the movie.
Holy shit. I'm so messed up with this movie that at any given time and any given day in my household, I could just spew a line from it. And luckily my family loves the movie too.
Yeah.
So they know what I'm doing. You know what I mean? But I would say if I had to pick, I would have to pull something from his, you know, from his monologue when he's really pissed off with her, when he says, you know, "Wendy, darling, light of my life," that whole thing, that whole, you know, I'm going to bash him right the fuck in. I love that.
That's a great line.
And anything that happens in the bathroom between him and Grady,
yeah,
with "I corrected her," that whole conversation word for word is, I mean, it's
Jack's face
sometimes.
In that scene's hilarious too. He's like, he's fucked up.
Mr. Grady.
Like he's like when you have like six drinks and you're walking around the bar and you think you're hot shit, but you really look like a jackass and you don't know it. And nobody's gonna tell you that. That's exactly what he looks like right there. He's like, oh yeah.
Oh, it's great.
My favorite line, and I've said it a bunch of times. "Sell my goddamn soul for a glass of beer." I know it's gonna sound bad, but like my grandpa used to drink a lot. It's just like, see my grandpa saying that when he's just like upset, he's just like, "Oh, I just sold my goddamn soul for a glass of beer."
Amazing.
Go ahead.
There's the theory I have about that moment, because he says that is the first time he sees Lloyd and he has his first actual interaction with somebody who really isn't there. At least
he's willing to sell himself over to the hotel.
Basically, yeah, it's like an open invitation. Oh, here's another great line. "Are you out of your fucking mind?" When she runs in and she tells him all that stuff about, "There's a crazy woman, he tried to strangle me," all that shit. And then the one line, it's comedy. When he walks in and when Grady spills the drink on him, the avocado, and they're going to thing, he goes, "Yes," he goes, "I intended to change anyway before the fish and goose soiree."
I love that he pats him on the back and he wipes that shit. No, there's lots of great little details like that, but that's a great scene between when she comes in and yells at him about that, because she initially blames him for the attack, and then she comes in and tells him all that. So then he starts to think she's fucking crazy too. So they're both thinking, right, "You're the one who fucking did it. You're blaming it on me. What the fuck is wrong with you?" Know what I mean? And like, right, they both, like, even Jack starts thinking she's off for a while. Like,
exactly.
Yeah, but like, we also know, like, Stanley Kubrick put these motherfuckers through the grinder. Like, the only one who, like, how do you make Scatman Crothers cry? Like, I would have been like, you know, if you're like, Jax is standing there and is like, dude just starts crying, you're just like, dude, that's enough. That's a fucking enough, dude. He made him do it like 50. Fuck. How many times? How many times did he make him do that?
It's some outrageous amount, like 70 something. I don't know. Some outrageous amount, though. And it was like, I think wasn't he reported to have said, Mr. Kubrick, what do you want? Or something like that. I can't even, it's not funny, but
yeah, I already done the same thing. I'm like, what do you want? I'm like, I'm not doing this any fucking more. I swear. Like, so like, that's funny. Scatman Crothers got to be buddies with Nicholson because they were in One for the Cuckoo's Nest together a few years before. Yeah. And I mean, like, Scatman Crothers had a great career. You know, I mean, he's mm-hmm. in The Shootist with John Wayne. His scene with John Wayne's brilliant. So, I mean, I always liked him, but I don't know. Yeah. I feel bad for anybody in a Kubrick movie. Like, he's got guys that I just can't see taking that shit. Like George C. Scott. I'd be like, I can't see him taking that shit.
No, it's weird, isn't it? Right.
Well, they respected him. I don't think he used to be as bad as he was either. I think like when he got, I don't know. I think he was trying to drive these fuckers crazy for real because he wanted that in the movie.
Well, it worked for Shelley Duvall, which I'm glad you mentioned that earlier. Yeah, I mean, unfortunately as well. Yeah, I mean, she went through all kinds of mental anguish, and you see where she's at
now. And then Dr. Phil drug her out, and then, you know, Dr. Phil is like, oh, I'm going to tell you how bad Stanley Kubrick is for exploiting you by fucking exploiting you.
Yeah, well said. Yeah, okay, you're right
Dr.
about that.
Dr. Phil Cannibal Holocaust over here. Exploitation movie by exploiting people.
Totally. Wow. Yeah, that's terrible. And, you know, obviously that didn't make her go crazy. There's obviously issues there.
Didn't help.
And that's maybe that set it off. But you said it earlier about her performance. And I agree. I think that she kind of gets razzed a little bit. But I think that her performance is fantastic in this movie.
The
just
cigarette
like
scene is the best performance by an actress, I think, in any movie this year. Like, I can't think of a better actress performance than Shelley Duvall. It's got to be Shelley Duvall. Like, who else is better? I'm trying to think. I can't think of an actress performance that's better. Dangerous Encounters of the First Kind's a great performance, but that's more of an exploitation kind of thing.
Right.
I think it might be her.
She is great. I mean, the stress that she shows and all the argument, you know, just everything that she's doing with Jack, it's like a master class when the two of them are going back and forth in that scene, you know, going up the stairs. And when she first comes in the room and reads All Work and No Play, and he comes in, how do you like it? And that whole conversation between the two of them.
Yeah.
I don't know. I can't imagine that was done in one take because it's Kubrick. But I mean, boy, they are so on point. And when she shows fear as like a genuine quote unquote scream queen, when she's being tormented and she's in the bathroom and he's coming at her with the axe and her reactions and everything, nobody talks about her in that respect. Everybody just kind of like, I don't know, it's like kind of maybe Jack just like steals the show so much that they don't, I don't know what it is, but am I the only one that thinks that? Doesn't it seem like
people
don't give her the respect?
Good, but like they always bring up Jack Nicholson probably because it's Jack Nicholson. We also have to remember that when this movie came out, everybody's like, Jack Nicholson's overacting so bad. It's the worst performance ever. Like, reading stuff like that. And you're just like, are you on fucking drugs? Like, didn't you get a Razzie? Like, it's fucking hilarious what the Razzies get. They know nothing. They know fucking nothing. Because
nothing.
I when I was watching the special features on Friday the 13th, Sean Cunningham, Betsy Palmer was repeating what Sean Cunningham was telling her. He said, now keep it internal. Don't go too external. You don't want to end up like Jack Nicholson in The Shining. And it's just like, oh, wow. Like, I know that's a great performance in Friday the 13th and all, but it doesn't hold a fucking candle to Jack Nicholson, like, in anything.
No.
Like, it's just so weird that Sean Cunningham, like, as much as I like some of his movies, he's a hack, talking shit about Stanley Kubrick and Jack Nicholson, right?
Yeah, of course.
Like,
I think he was just kind of, think he was just
everybody
doing
hated
that
it at the time. Everybody hated it at the time, so everybody thought it was shit. That just goes to show you what the general public can convince the masses what shit.
It's a scary thought.
They convinced the masses that The Shining was a bad movie.
That's insane. And now look at the way it's looked at. I mean, you're talking about 1980 movies, and I didn't realize this was your last one. I know that I've seen some of
the big ones. I have two more to watch after this, but this is like the big recordings. Like, cause I did all the heavy hitters, like not all of them.
Right.
The heavy hitters I had already watched, I basically did a little recording with them, or unless I could find like a special guest to do something special with it.
Okay, well, this is what I have to say about 1980 movies and this. Everything I've watched this year so far for the 1980 show seems like it's filmed in 1979 or earlier. This particular movie, the way they're dressed looks 70s and certain other things. But when I'm watching the movie itself, it does not feel at all to me like a 70s movie. It seems like it's from later on in the 80s almost. It's the soundtrack. It's the look of it. Everything about it feels different than everything else we're watching for this 80s show. Do you agree?
I would agree that it's different because it's Kubrick at the same time, because Kubrick doesn't use typical soundtracks. He uses a lot of classical music, which is very unlike anything from 1980, really. Because 1980 either has like carryover from disco shit, or it has like the synth stuff or whatever, or even like some old like 70s stuff or whatever. But his music is always different. They always stands out. Like, I mean, think of like Clockwork Orange, it's mostly classical music as well. So, and on top of that, we're watching a lot of movies that are made by exploitation and horror directors, and Kubrick is not bad. And that's another thing about, you know, all our favorite horror directors, the masters of horror, they didn't want to get pigeonholed into making horror movies. The guys that wanted to make horror movies for a living, typically, they're probably not the best horror directors. Like Romero and Carpenter and even Fulci. Well, Dario wanted to make that shit. He tried different, but most of them don't typically want to make horror movies. But some of the greatest horror movies ever made are by guys that only made one or two horror movies ever. And The Shining is one of those, right? He is not his
freaking
thing. Freaking. You know? One or two horror movies. Exorcist, maybe Guardian, which isn't a great movie. Cruising.
Spielberg. Arguable.
Yeah, Spielberg, you got Jaws. So, like, yeah, you know, it's guys, you know, that they like genre films, but they don't even like to stick in one genre, or they most definitely, you know, it's just a subject matter that interested him. And Kubrick's half of his fucking movies were based off books.
Right. Yeah, right. It's so true. Yeah.
It's funny. Pretty wild. The best director is making unoriginal movies. As if people are making original ideas. It's like back in the 60s and 70s, some of the best movies ever made were based off books. We can go back to that and stop remaking movies.
Right? Yeah. How come that's a good point. It's not like people stopped writing books. There's still books out there, and there's still
lots of great books. This
untouched, you know, stuff from, you know, the past that no one's ever made a movie about that. Yeah. Even if it doesn't fit with, you know, 2022 times, you could still update it. You know what I mean? Even if it was written in the 60s, you could still take the themes and the characters from it and just update it to modern times. I would think that they would do this stuff.
And let's be honest, half the movies that were adapted from those books aren't even correctly adapted. Like the Blade Runner is nothing like the book.
Well, they right.
Yeah. I don't know how you make that fucking book. That book's on drugs. But there's a lot of those books that are on drugs. So I don't know. Like, I prefer the movie, this movie, over the book.
I think too.
Kubrick's a better director than King's a writer. I know that's probably, it's true though. One's more complex to me.
Well, look at it this way. I understand why you would say that, but look at how many at-bats King has compared to how many at-bats Kubrick has.
Kubrick only made a handful of movies, and they're all masterpieces, you know what I mean? Right?
They are. You're right. I mean, he can't make a bad movie. I agree with you. Like, at least one. From, you know, production values and everything else. And I'm not going to sit here and say I've seen every Kubrick, but I've seen most of them. And yeah, I don't think he can make, I haven't seen anything bad from him. King... The thing about King is he may be the best character writer that we've ever had. When you read his books, the way he dives into character, and King just has
a wealth of knowledge. He's the best suburban writer. Like, he appeals to suburbia better than anybody else. Like, Clive Barker does not appeal to suburbia. He appeals to transgressive people. I love Barker.
Or
like
too.
Lovecraft. Yeah. Like, that doesn't appeal to suburbia. He's my favorite, one of my favorites, but King appeals to almost everybody. You know what I mean? King is like I don't want to use this as a bad thing. You know, King is like, he somehow can go super dark, but still appeal to the masses, which is a rarity. But King's like a shark. He has to keep writing no matter what.
I know, right?
Kubrick may be the same, but he just is so meticulous or pre-plans everything to such an extreme level that, you know what I mean? Like, he doesn't get that many out, or he might only make a movie when he absolutely has to. Unlike Jess Franco or fucking Jody Amato or John Roland, who have some great movies, but they have some garbage because that's all they do is make movies, and they just keep doing it. That's the same thing with King. I'm not comparing Jody Amato to Stephen King, but I am. No, you know what I mean? It's just the way they work. King was much more successful, obviously, but still, like,
King doesn't have to do it.
The directors had to do it
to make a career at
or
this
they felt
point.
Like and, they had to do it or they right. Were, yeah.
I think King does it because of his addictions. I think he can't stop. I think that if he stops writing, he'll pick up the bottle again or do something. This is just a theory, yeah. Because I know of some musicians that always keep busy because what do they say about the idle hands or the devil's plaything? I think they just keep going because they're afraid to actually sit back on the couch and just chill. I'm like, okay, now what? And then I think they'll go into old, bad habits.
Bad habits. But some of his best work was when he was in those bad habits.
For sure.
Does he remember one of them?
Is it The Shining?
It might be. I don't remember. But I can't remember which one it is. I know it's not Carrie because that was like his first.
Nope.
One of the big ones too.
Might have been Pet Cemetery.
I think it is my Pet Cemetery for sure. But like we have a lot of the themes here, like The Shining, that kind of telekinetic or telepathy powers, definitely third, sixth sense or whatever, appears in a lot of his stories. A lot of people seem to have it. So saying that, do you think that Jack Torrance had it as well, or he had a touch of it because he was so affected by the hotel?
Sure. Maybe that's why he drank. Maybe that's like an allegory for Stephen King himself and why he drank. Maybe, you know what I mean? It's like the same thing because it quells the thoughts. It numbs them. Actually, they kind of played upon that. I think he probably did that on purpose because if you read Dr. Sleep or even just saw
I saw the movie. I didn't read the book.
I think that they straight up say that in the movie that, Danny was able to dull the shining that he had by drinking and not allowing himself to think. Does that come right from the book? I can't profess to know, but I have a feeling maybe.
Well, yeah. I mean, that makes sense that he would have the substance abuse and then it would pass on to his son. It's got to come from somewhere. It's got to be some hereditary passing on or something like that. Or everybody has it just stronger in there. Do you think, how long ago did they say Grady murdered his family? 10 years ago?
Oh, when did they say it was?
Okay, not too long ago. So Grady, do you think that the house only preys on people with the shine? Or do you think that it can get to anybody?
No, I think that the overlook, it's kind of like I buy into what Scatman Crothers said. Bad things have happened here, and sometimes it leaves a trace. And I think a lot of bad things happened there. I think that the hotel in itself is evil, and that's why things can happen. And if you shine, you're more prone to see them, and they're more, they can dig into you. You know what I mean? They can like punch the hole into this world more. Because if you look at it this way, Wendy at the end of the movie, when the hotel wakes up for good, she sees it and she's not known to shine or anything like that. So I feel that the hotel just gets more powerful because more is opened up with them.
Or Danny opened it up for everybody
to
see.
That's possible. Because he doesn't have control over it like Scatman Crothers would. Like, or he knows things are there. But
So here's a question. So you die in the Overlook and you become some sort of ghost or you're there sucked into it. Was Scatman Crothers stuck in there after he died in there?
Oh, wow.
I can't see it. I can't see Dick Halloran dying in there and being stuck in there.
I think some people have always been there. They've lived other lives there. And that is why Jack Nicholson, obviously we get the picture at the end, from 1921 or whatever it is. I think people look at it different ways, but the way I've come to interpret it is he has been there before. He has a soul that's been involved in this before. And he even says to Wendy, he goes, the first time I came here for the tour, he says, it was almost as if I knew what was around every corner. And he goes, and then he's like, I never felt so comfortable in my life or something. And he's only been there like a month. You know what I mean? So it's like they wanted him. He's been there. He was there in 1921. Yeah, there's so many different ways to look. See, I've come up with one of the things about this movie and why I love it so much is I've been able to come up with answers to the questions. Some, and I might have a discussion and some say, well, I don't buy that. But I always try with movies, especially movies that I like, to explain. And if I can come up with my own explanations, that's what I've done over the years with this one, with all the times I've watched it.
It could be that, or it could be that the hotel absorbs you and you're now a permanent guest in there to live throughout the history of the horrible acts or whatever, live through the, it could be interpreted either way. So, I mean, it's a very interesting movie. Like, it's just so weird and different. The one thing that I did notice is like, I know a lot of people do point, and I think you mentioned this too, like they point out a lot of the beautiful locations, but the one part I noticed how good and how well decorated it was when Wendy was running and she's going through all that blue, all those hallways that are blue. I was like, man, all this stuff, the set design is so gorgeous just in this like throwaway shit background. You know what I mean?
Yes. They use colors so well, but in not in obvious ways. That's like what you said. You have to pick up on it and stuff, and what they do with the reds, with the blood and all that stuff. And I mean, and even like, I'll tell you when the colors pop, when room 237, which I love. Everybody talks about the overlook, the hotel carpet. I love the carpet and the colors and the way room 237 looks. It's just like some,
it looks like something from,
yeah.
Don't
yeah,
ever carpet
crazy.
The fucking bathroom.
Wait a minute. Is the bathroom carpeted? I don't know this. I don't think it is. I don't think it is. Maybe it is. And if it is, that's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
But I just know that the way the rug looks, I love it. It looks more like something that you'd see in an Argento flick.
Yeah.
Honestly, the decorations of it. It's just in the gold room. Oh, I was just telling my daughter yesterday. I said, man, I want to win the lottery, because if I ever won the lottery, I would have the gold room. I would have a perfect mock-up of that whole place. It'd be a party room in my house. The bar, exactly.
You're talking about the big ballroom?
The colors, yeah.
Oh, that's fucking huge, man. It takes so long to clean it.
Hey, I'm a lottery winner. I'm rich. I'm saying if I could afford something like that, and that would be like the place to be. I'd have parties there and stuff. Come on, we're going to the gold room. And I'd have that song playing half the time.
Yeah. Like I said, all like classical music. He never really has like that typical score. There's a lot of things that set this apart from other 1980 movies. I mean, there's a couple ghost stories, but there's no ghost story kind of like this. There's no like real malicious ghost. Like these are truly malicious spirits, unlike The Fog, who are out for justifiable revenge, or The Changeling, which is a very classic ghost story, which is, you know, you got to help me solve this because this is unfair. You know, this is unjust. So there's like two unjust. There's nothing that these ghosts or this house, it's evil, which is a strange thing. Yeah. And there's not anything quite like it in terms of other ghost stories, except maybe Death Ship, which I don't think you've watched.
I've seen it one time. Yeah,
it's enough.
I didn't hate it either. It's
enough. It's fine. It's fine. It's a rip off The Shining, you know, even from the blood shower, just like the blood elevator. I mean, it's okay.
Oh, yeah. Right. Wow. Except
George Kennedy is no Jack Nicholson, although I love George Kennedy. Not the type to play that performance as well as Jack. But and also Watcher in the Woods from 1980, the Disney film, has a lift directly from The Shining. Remember that?
I got to look at my notes to see, because I've already watched it and I have notes for it. Now you're going to...
The background that she gets the dog and like, what are we going to name it? Like, name it. And like, name it. She writes it backwards and it's fucking Karen. I was like, go fuck yourself. Like, I don't know if that was in the book, but it came like, I was like, this is garbage. Like, it's not, like, there's no way. It had to be lifted directly from The Shining. I'm just like, fuck off.
It's funny. Laughing. I didn't even think about that.
Yeah. There's all that kind of shit in there. Like,
Nilbog in freaking Troll 2.
You're just like, stop it. And then fucking, they all thought they were clever. Troll 2, it's called Goblet. It's not even fucking trolls.
Right.
And then Troll 3 is about killer roots.
Right. Oh, it's ridiculous. What about Alucard? That started it, if you think about
it. The Dracula. Yeah. But Alucard is a great movie too. Yeah.
Sure.
So, there's also some other comparisons. What was I getting at with this? Oh, geez. I knew there's a couple movies that were vaguely similar to The Shining. Now I'm losing it. Oh, yeah. Phantom Carriage. Have you watched that?
I started watching it and I didn't finish it.
There is an axe or a hatchet through a door. I don't know if Kubrick saw it, but it's similar to The Shining. And then, of course,
I've heard this before.
A year later, Fulci lifted it for House by the Cemetery and they do the hatchet through the door. Which is also a ghost story and a weird ghost story too. House by the Cemetery is a fucking whack ghost story. It doesn't feel like one, but it is. It's like a mad scientist ghost story, which is a strange combination. So, I mean, like as far as this year is concerned, you have literally like so many horror directors and so much crazy shit going on. This has got to be one of the most crazy, violent, nihilistic years ever.
It is pretty whacked out.
Mean-spirited.
Yeah, I mean... You have the exploitation film, you have Maniac, and you know the kickoff of the slashers and all the other stuff, which good old 80s, you know.
1980 is a strong year. Like, you could take it like other like psychopaths in this year. You got Betsy Palmer, Joe Spinell, David Hess, Nicholas Worth, and they're like, their movies range in quality. Obviously, not everything could be The Shining, but their performances are very good and like very, I would say, comparable to a certain extent, but different. You know what I mean? Different kind of psychopaths and stuff. I don't know. It's a classic movie. Like, this is one for me that you put in the history books, like The Naysayers. It's just like, who gives a shit what you have to say? Like, I know it's like, there's just like 100 movies that where people are like, I think this movie sucks. And you're just like, cool. Not even going to engage in this kind of talk. Like Texas right. Chainsaw, Halloween. It's like, it doesn't matter what I think of those movies. The book's closed.
But yeah, of course the book's closed. Absolutely.
Case is closed.
But I'll tell you.
Like, yeah, case is closed.
But this movie here, you can say what you want about slasher movies and other stuff like that. This movie here, how could you dispute that it's not well made?
You
know what I mean? You know what I mean? Like the other movies, and again, no one loves Friday the 13th more than I do. I'm just saying, but anybody can come and tear it apart for this reason or that to a certain degree. Yeah. Well, this and that's cheap and blah, and you can see this here, and the acting isn't top notch, or the dialogue's bad. I get that. I enjoy it for other reasons on another level, but this movie here, I can't understand. It's almost like, I mean, you can't say the word can't, but I want to say you can't say this is a bad movie. Well, you know what I mean?
People that say it's like a poorly made movie, like, you just got to stop. Like there's only so many certain things you can take when somebody says like too many hot takes like that, where you're just like, now I'm just going to be like Paulie from The Goodfellas. Now I got to walk away from you. You know what I mean? Like, now I got to walk away from you.
Very good.
Like, it's like, that's enough. You just can't totally. Like, you stop taking their opinion. Like, every once in a while, as long as they admit it, like, it's a great movie, I don't like it. Like, that's okay. Or like, yeah, I understand why you like it. It's not for me. But they're like, this is a poorly made film. You'd be like, not script.
Yeah.
This is a film. Like, this is like, this is like, do you think the cinematography's bad? Like, the set design's bad? What world are we in? Like,
they just say it sucks. That's just the word they use. Oh, The Shining sucks.
Sucks. Why? It's my brain doesn't work. Like, it's fine if you're at work and somebody's like, that movie sucks. You're like, okay. We don't have to have this conversation ever. But like, if you're talking to somebody that likes horror movies and they're just like, it sucks. You're like, that's it. That's what we're getting. Like, why are we doing this? I don't even need to ask you. We're both being on the top 10 show, top 25 on 22 shots. So like, we can't get into what we rank above it, but I'm pretty sure I know you're 1 and 2. Like, it's the most obvious.
I'm sure
one
you
and
do.
Two. I'm pretty sure you can guess my 1 at least. Pretty easily.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's just the way I am. It's movies you've seen at a certain age that have had a very adverse or a crazy effect on you. So, like, is there anything else you want to talk about in The Shining? I mean, we kind of just glanced the surface, really, but there's a lot.
There is a lot. I mean, it still scares me to this day. And it's very rare for anything to scare me. And when they do, I hold it in high regard. The twin scene, it doesn't matter. So the day I die, I'll always be creeped out by anything involving the Grady girls. Anything. The first time you see them, the way they look at each other, when he's playing darts, when the whole Hello Danny conversation, and, you know, later on when he goes into room 237. And the thing is, though, that is scary when the lady, that is creepy. And I put myself in that position. Like, to this day, I don't want to be in a hotel. Every time I'm in a hotel, if I'm in a hallway by myself at night, which usually when I'm in a hotel, it is at nighttime when you're, you know, getting ready for bed or you go to get ice or whatever you're doing in a hotel, I always get just a tad bit creeped out because of this movie. And I think about certain things, but so it creeps me out. Now, the thing with the lady, it is scary, but every time I watch it now, I break out in laughter because of how long she keeps laughing. It's scary, but it's also funny. After he closes the door and he's running down the hall, the old lady is still in the room with the door locked and closed, laughing. Just like sitting there by herself laughing. I find
Is she in the bathtub too?
Yeah, she's in the bathtub. She rises out. They show the thing.
I thought, did she go back in the bathtub and start laughing, or she's just standing there? I can't remember.
No, the last time we see her is when she's, you know, stepping towards him, and then he locks the door and runs, and then we just hear her, but she keeps on laughing. The scene even fades away to Dick Holler and making a phone call from Florida, and you still hear the laughing going. It's creepy, but it's funny at the same time that she's still sitting in there laughing. You know.
Now, do you think that Kubrick killed Dick Halloran just so it would be completely different from the book? Because it's such a like a huge buildup of him like calling and going, and then he just promptly gets axed. You're just like, what the fuck was the point of that? You really do think that for a minute.
But I'll tell you what, I was thinking of just watching it.
Because he gets hit and then they get away because of it.
He was the sacrificial lamb. Yeah. I mean, because he showed up, things did happen. He was a distraction. Yeah. But it's also kind of, it just speaks to the evil of this hotel, thinking that all this time, the guy wakes up in the morning, he has to make phone calls, he has to make a plane ride. It touches down at 8:20 a.m. Then he calls the guy. Then he says, I'm going to drive. I'll be there in 5 hours to get the snowcat. So this guy spends like 24 hours straight just to go into this place for 2 minutes to get to killed immediately. It's crazy, but it just shows how evil. I mean, you think that the first time you see this movie, you think, oh, this, you know, Dick's going to save the day. You know what I mean? And then he gets, oh, nope, not in this movie. And I kind of like it. I kind of like that.
I mean, it's different.
Yeah. It's almost like Rob Dyer in Friday the 13th, the final chapter, who sets his whole life to avenge his sister's death.
Which one? Part four?
Yeah, and, you know.
And then he just gets manhandled.
It's the same thing.
Fuck that idiot. He's like commentating his own death. The moron. He's killing
prepared. Yeah. Oh, it's so funny.
So, also, the one thing that I like is like every time something real fucked up happens, it does that boom. It does those stings, and they're good stings. Mm. Like there's a lot of bad movie stings that you hear 1,000 times that are pure dog shit. Like the stings in this one, I think one hits when Halloran gets hit with the axe. I think there's one where he runs from the Grady's girls. I think there's one there too. Genuinely very scary. So
absolutely.
Like, it has the tropes a lot, like I said, but it's a little different. You don't typically see evil ghosts that are... These are not for revenge. They're not. Like, they're just, you know, they're just bad. Usually ghosts are out for revenge.
Some are just partying. Yeah. What about the guy with the drink? Great party. And what about the guy with the dog and the blowjob and the freaking thing? They're just doing their thing.
Pretty scary.
I agree. There's, not a friendly it dog. It is a little scary.
Not
True.
A friendly dog.
Now, here's my question about
the book. He's not
scene.
Friendly at all. He actually comes after
in the book. Yeah, that's right. And they don't wasn't it? Didn't it happen at a party? And these guys started carrying on at some ball that was happening there. And the one guy, as a joke, took a leash and put it around the dog. And they started, you know, gallivanting. And then they ended up hooking up together or something weird like that.
I think
it was some weird happenstance thing where these two dudes just got together.
Yeah,
but
it was strange. And he's like, they're obviously like, he's a bad person or something weird. Like, he tries to eat Danny or some shit.
Yeah, I remember that. And the hedge maze. It wasn't a hedge maze. It was the hedge animals. And that was scary in the book. But that's... Yeah. That's a whole other thing. But here's a question about the dog. Oh, it's cool. Oh, it's amazing. I mean,
the scene where Jack sees him in the hedge maze is one of the best. That's like his first moment where he's losing his shit. And you're just like, what?
Man.
I don't even know how they did that.
I look every time to see.
I still don't know how they did it. I can't find it. I know. I can't spot it. I can't spot the minute. I don't know what's going on.
How about that scene when Jack's just sitting there and they're playing that low music and he's just
staring off,
drifting off? Dude.
I used that in my 1980 opening. You saw that.
Yeah.
Did you watch that opening?
Amazing. Yeah. I saw it was on the regular video you did.
I used so much different. I used all my favorites in that, the opening and stuff like that. A lot of great dialogue, lots of great music, lots of crazy shit. Mm-hmm. Like everybody.
The score. The score for this movie, nobody ever talks about it amongst like the best scores. So many things going on in the score in this movie. And it's just overlooked because there's just so many things. This is the opening thing. Yeah. But there's so many things throughout. And sometimes they're repeated, just like Halloween and Friday and the other ones, you know. But I mean, I feel like it's an overlooked score. Nobody really talks about like The Shining amongst like, you know, what are the best scores for horror movies? It doesn't. It seems like it's slept on. It's really a damn good score. It's creepy. Something else about the movie, like technically I can't find one thing wrong. Well, me being that it's my favorite movie, I can't find anything wrong with it anyway.
I mean I don't really find anything wrong with it either. It's like, you know, I have my personal favorites, and this is in my top 100. It does make my top 100 when I was doing my list. Nice. Actually, on rewatch this time I bumped it up. Like I was like, It's in my top 10. Okay. I bumped it up higher in my top 10. So, I mean, it's in my top 10 of 1980 for sure. It's not my top 10 of 100.
Okay. But still,
we're talking quality movies, it is like not personal favorites, but it's in my top 100. It's so hard to start rating these fucking movies. I think this is probably my cousin's favorite horror movie. He's not a huge, he likes movies like Ready Open, but I think this is his favorite.
Oh, that's great.
I got in a heated argument with him once. He thought The Shining was creepier than The Thing. And I was like, I didn't think. And then I think back on it. And I was like, no, by definition, The Shining is creepier.
Creepier.
The Thing may be scarier because what's going to happen. But the definition of creepy is The Shining.
Yeah. Does creep me out to this day. It's like, it works. It has these moments that work on me. And that's not easy to do. How many movies actually creep you out? I mean, Session 9 actually kind of does. Yeah. There's certain things that go on there, but I mean, not a whole lot.
I think that every reasonable human being can understand that there's a chance that they could lose their mind, and there's nothing scarier than losing control completely.
Yeah. That is an awful thought.
Yeah. So something affecting your mind too.
How do you even, I mean, it's like you said, what's really at hand here? Who are people losing their mind? Are there ghosts? Are there possessions? Is it all of the above?
Is it The Shining? You know what I mean? Is fucking Danny just fucking shining everybody and they're all fucking losing their shit?
And then he goes away. That's the crazy part. So he, when shit really hits the fan, all of a sudden it's Danny's not here, Mrs. Torrance.
Yeah.
His physical self, his mental self, can't take what's happened.
Shuts down.
Yes, he shuts down, and then freaking this other side comes out, and
he pulls a Barbara from Night of the Living Dead. He just refuses to deal with the situation. Knows it's hopeless. Yeah. They shut down. They're like, I'm not doing this. I'm not playing this game. I'll just, if I die, I die. It's over. I'm not doing this.
Who could blame him? I mean,
it happens like more than people would like to admit. That we're just like, the apocalypse. Somebody's like, I'm ready for the apocalypse. Half the people just like, just waiting to die. I guarantee like 20% of people just kill themselves. Like if nuclear war happens, they just blow their brains out right on the spot.
Wouldn't be surprising. No, I feel you.
Why bother? Like, we got to eat my dog. It's like, nah, we're not doing that. I think I'm good on that. I think I'm just going to die.
Yeah. You don't know until you're there, but you're talking about evil and ghosts and stuff like this. Yeah, you don't know how you're going to react. And I just feel bad for I even feel bad for Jack. At the end of the movie, this is the way I take it. I think at the end of the movie, they release him. Well, first of all, I think the last time he hangs on to humanity is when he has that dream. Because he's like a different person. Danny, when he wakes up. Yes, and the way he's talking to her. Yes.
That seems like a real moment. Yeah. That is a good moment.
He's like in tears in front of his wife. He's endearing himself to her. That shows something in the relationship. And he's like, to me, that's like his last moments of humanity. And I think they're gone until the very end of the movie. And I think at the very end of the movie, when he's trapped in the snow and he hears the snow cat come up and everything, and the hotel knows that he failed, I think that the hotel releases him and turns him back to a person. And when he's calling, Danny, Wendy, I think that he's like hypothermia and stuff is setting in, and he's really actually calling out.
Having a realization.
As a family man. Yes. That I want help and I've been abused all this time and now they just let me go and here I am. And that's terrifying.
You know, like, and there's like deep, they obviously use the resentment that Jack has towards, you know, Wendy, because like, it's not Wendy's fault, but Jack blames her for his failures. You know, like if I wouldn't have had the kid, I could have been a famous writer, you know, I wouldn't be a drunk, you know, all this shit. He's blaming it on her because he's got fragile, you know, masculine. He's fragile. I mean, sensitive, stupid, you know, like most guys, sensitive and stupid, but they try to hide it at the at all costs.
Right, true. And I do love that line though. That one line when he's speaking of that, when he says, I've let you fuck up my life so far, but I am not gonna let you fuck this up. I love that fucking shit.
Yeah, he blames her for everything, you know, like that resentment. Yeah, I mean, it's a great movie. Any last things you want to say about it?
That scene with Jack and his son in the bed when he wakes up to go get his fire truck, that conversation, you just feel the kid being afraid of his father by the way he sits there. The kid sells it so well too. And just the way that scene is played out, it's in the music that's playing during it. It's a different kind of creepy. It's almost like, I don't know, like I just get like a freaking, a very uncomfortable feeling when I think about like a real life situation where somebody abuses their kid and like later on they're trying to be nice to him, but the kid in the back of his head knows I can never trust my father fully again. It's deep. And that, I know that gets to me. I just wanted to mention that scene.
There's definitely a great way that they show fear through a child. And you get that a lot here. The bike, Jack, kind of being terrified to wake your dad up when he's taking a nap because you know you're just going to get chewed out or yelled at or maybe worse. So like there's that feeling, you know, back there. Like there's a lot of that too. Fear through a child. Like you see lots of different ways through fear is put through. You have fear through Jack and all his fucking failures, fear through Wendy and like the obviously trauma that she has, and fear through Danny, just all that kind of shit. You know, and even hell, fear through Scatman Crothers worrying about what's going to happen to them, Danny. So I mean, there's like lots of different ways of what people being afraid in this movie. And I feel like they capture Danny's fear pretty well, especially like the ideas of having to go in and be quiet. And like you expect him to wake him up, but he's already fucking up. Just sitting
there. That's creepy when he's sitting there, the way he's just sitting there like this, and the music they play, and then he turns. Oh, man. That nobody ever talks about that scene, but everything about that disturbs me. That's the one scene in this movie that disturbed me. That's the perfect word for it. Something about it, man. It's just, I don't know. Man, yeah, this movie.
You don't expect,
I could go on and on.
There's a lot of things you don't expect. Like you don't expect Scatman Crothers to bite it. You don't expect him to be sitting up. There's just a lot of different things that you don't really expect to happen, you know. Like I said, it's a lot of manipulation too, and he's definitely manipulating the audience and what the characters say. You don't know who to trust, exactly what the hell's going on. And it probably upset people a lot, you know, but I think it's great. I think it's a classic for a reason. I think it's one of the best horror movies in 1980, one of the best horror movies ever made.
Right on. I agree. Of course.
Do you want to plug anything?
Exploding Heads. We're on Patreon. And we're wherever everything else is played, you know, Apple, Stitcher, all that good stuff. And Wat-Zee Party Horror Show, same thing. And I just joined Jay of the Dead's new horror movies, which has 9 hosts. And it's a crazy, great situation. And I think you guys should check all these shows out. Yep. And that's it.
You should also.
Thank you.
Yeah, for sure. If you never listened to Exploding Heads, is there an episode you want them to start with? Top 50 slashers, favorite slashers?
Oh, man. Episode 50 is a great one. Yeah. I mean, that's one that I'll say is great. I don't usually like say my stuff is, but we worked hard on that one. So, yeah, episode 50. And, man, I can't wait to get to episode 200. I'm really looking forward to
that. I
got to
make my list still. I've been fucking around with
it. Are you going
to? Yeah, I'll make it eventually. I just look at it. I'm just like, ugh. And then like. Like I don't have time to rewatch all these classics that should be on my list, but I fucking, you know, I was like, I don't know why I watched Cannibal Apocalypse 4 times last year, but I didn't watch, you know, I was like, shit like that. Like, it's just, but it is what it is. So I appreciate you doing this. Yeah, we have to come on some other time. Like if anybody ever has a Friday 13th question, you should ask Dave Zee or Christian from Exploding Heads.
That's fair.
Your love for Friday 13th actually made me appreciate that series more. I mean, I always liked it, but it was never my favorite series, but I've always felt it was the most solid series because the highs and lows of the other movies are really high or really fucking low. Like for me, sure. None of the Fridays beat Hellraiser 1, but like,
that's fair. I love Hellraiser 1.
Not even the worst Friday ever is lower than like Hellraiser, like 4. You know what I mean? Like, it gets bad in those series. Like, and Friday only has a couple bad ones. Like, 8's a piece of shit. I can't stand 8. I can't stand
8 and 9.
I can't stand 8. I know, I barely
Jason
remember
goes to
9.
Hell. Jason can't goes stand to hell. 8.
I barely remember it.
That's, yeah, you don't want to. That's
I remember
fine.
It as a kid and I'd never rewatched it. But 8, I like always would come on TV and I'd watch 25 minutes and I'm like, I can't fucking watch this thing. It's fucking awful. It's like Nightmare on Elm Street 5. I'm just like, I can't fucking watch this thing. I can't watch this movie.
I'm with you. Or Halloween freaking Resurrection. You know?
I'm gonna be honest with you. I don't think I finished. I think I only saw it on TV and only bits and pieces. And I was just like, no, man. I just can't watch this. I can't watch this.
Lucky. Good. There's no reason to watch it. So so would you say out of the big three then that Friday is your favorite now?
I mean, I'd watch the series more. I mean, like, you're talking about the big three. I mean, I like Nightmare on Elm Street better than any Friday.
The movie itself, you mean?
Just the first one.
Oh, I have no problem with that.
But I don't.
I adore it.
I like Friday 1 through 5. I could watch any time. They're a comfort food. They're very easy. Six, I like, but I don't get the appeal as I got older. I used to like it more, but it just doesn't hold up for me as much. I don't know why. It was a little. And seven, same. It's okay, but like,
yeah.
As far as like, we go to Nightmare, like one, love it. Two, it's good. Three, love it. Four, I love it, but it's awful. Five, I hate. Six, I hate. Seven, I like. Eight is what? Freddy vs. Jason. It's okay. And then I never finished the remake. It's not my thing. The Friday.
We line up a lot with these franchises, honestly.
So one's great on Friday. Two's great. Three's good. Almost great. Four's great. Five is great. Six is good. Seven's okay. Yep. Eight's trash. Nine, I don't remember. Ten, I don't remember very well. I remember having Jason some fun X. shit, but I don't remember. Freddy vs. Jason, okay. And the remake is okay. Like, I don't know why it's as boring with that much nudity and boobs. And then we do Halloween. Halloween 1's a classic. Halloween 2, I barely remember. It's been years. I love Halloween 3. Barely remember part 4. And I've seen 4 and 5 a bunch because they're always on TV. Barely remember them. I remember 4 being better than 5. 6, I don't think I'll like again. It's been years. 7, I hate how movies look at that time. But I know a lot of people like it. 8, I wouldn't even watch again. And I like Rob Zombie's movies. I know people hate them, but I'm just like, I like the theatrical cut of part 1 without the rape. I like the Tom Cole shit with the cops. It's so much better. And then
I know.
It's
so
way
basic.
Better. It's so it's, funny,
and it's
too.
It's basic and good.
It's got Leslie Easterbrook, Bill Moseley, and Tom Cole's in it. And you cut that for fucking this weird rape scene that doesn't even fit. You cut out 4 fucking kills for that.
Yeah, that's...
And Tom Tolles got the best line in that whole fucking thing. Bill Moseley's like, trick or treat. And then Tom Tolles, I know we're going on a tirade here, but Tom Tolles is like, he's like, have a donut. He's like, you know how many goddamn sit-ups I'd have to do to burn off a donut?
So wait a minute. Now, I love all that stuff with the original Escape that you're talking about, but does that mean that they remove, what's his name? In the uncut, in the director's cut? When
Danny Trejo?
I was good to you, Mikey.
No, I think that's still in there. I still like it's in both versions.
Oh, well,
but
shit,
that's so like morbidly funny when he dies. Like I'll have to rewatch the theatrical version, like because you like feel bad for him. He's like, I was good to you, Mikey, but it's just like kind of laughing because he's the same Mikey. Like he's like talking to a Ninja Turtle. What's up, Mikey? Like I don't know, but no, I do enjoy that. It's been a while since I watched him, and like. Rob Zombie's had such like a shit streak lately. Like not too bad, but 31's bad. Like
the last three.
I'm so worried about putting those in and just being like, oh no, like these suck. Like the Halloween movie. I'll never hate Devil's Rejects or House of Thousand Corpses, but I could see myself slipping a little bit on those Halloween movies to be like, you know what I mean?
I've come up on them. Honestly.
I always liked them.
I've always loved 2. It took me a little time to watch 1. You know what it was for me with 1? When I decided to watch it and pretend the original didn't exist. And it's easier said than done. But I have learned to do that when it comes to remakes now. And it usually makes them more enjoyable. And it totally did with me. I stopped the comparisons.
I never had any ownership of Halloween. You know what I mean? Like, I never had it. Like, I'm excited for this Hellraiser movie because I love the first 2 Hellraisers a lot. And this one looks pretty good. And I can't believe it looks good. I can't. And perfect director. Perfect casting. Perfect tone and style. I was just like, that guy is the bowling guy that I was like, I've seen his other stuff. I was like, this guy's the guy to do this. Like, even no matter what I feel about his other movies, this is the guy. So I'm very excited for that. As far as we get in like Texas Chainsaw World too, like love the first one, love the second one. Third one's all right. Yeah. Fourth one's a piece of shit. Mm-hmm. The remake's okay. I like the beginning a little more than the remake.
Absolutely.
Turned off parts, the 3D, didn't finish that. Like Leatherface at all.
Nope, I don't either.
I think it's that one, that number 7, whatever the one. I think that's
the French directors.
I hate it. I think it's.
I don't hate it, but I just I'm not into it that much.
And then this new one, I thought was terrible but entertaining.
Oh,
I enjoyed it, but I was like, this is bad. Like that's the way I felt about Halloween Kills. Like this is a bad movie, but like
I love it.
12, and all it's just a bunch of killing, and I'm fine with it. I don't give a shit. It's part 12. It's part fucking 12. Like
true. This is where I notice you and I differ. Modern horror.
Yeah.
That's I think we see a lot alike in the 70s and 80s and stuff like that to a degree. 2022, 2021, you know, this era of horror, I feel like I enjoy them more than you do.
Probably do. I mean, but
especially franchise stuff.
I just don't get into the new. I lose interest in franchise even younger. Like I'd stop watching the Hellraiser movies at part 5 or 6. Like I was just like, that's enough for me. I get burnt out. Like,
yeah,
I've only seen up to Child's Play 4. I'm like, that's enough. And the remake, I was just like, that's enough. Like
see Curse. Oh, you
I didn't see Curse or Cult.
You would or like Seed. Curse. Oh, don't even bother with Seed. I mean, here's what I
watch
like.
Them all.
The first two, I like the first two, 1 and 2. And I like Curse and I like Cult and I like the remake. Everything in the middle, I don't like.
I think we differ in the 90s because I like part 3.
It was a little too comical for me. That's all.
Chucky shit is stupid. The whole concept to me is too dumb to take seriously. So when it was really serious in part 1, I was just like, all right. You know what I mean?
Yeah, no, I get it. It's a doll.
It's the voodoo shit that makes me laugh, not the doll. Like, okay. I don't like how he puts his soul into the doll. Like, in the very beginning part, I always crack up. Like, he's like, mom. I'm just like,
yeah.
I can't take it serious right now, man. Like, and it's dead straight pan. And you have to be dead straight pan for the movie to work, but it just, I don't know what it is. It's like crossing that line of just too goddamn dumb for me and being serious. But it's a good movie. I mean, like, come on. It is what it is, right?
I love it, actually. I get what you're saying, though, if you really break it down and think about somebody doing something like that. But that's
like
the thing about
shit.
The genre.
I don't know why. I like dumb shit, but it's just it has a very classy tone, so it's just bizarre.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's bizarre. It's a bizarre scene.
Yeah, it is. If you think about it, yeah. It's, I never thought about it until really you said
it. And like when Full Moon does shit like that, you're like, this sucks anyways, so I don't care. Like it's already like got a crappy tone, so you expect stupid shit. Like, but like Child's Play is all classy and it's like a serial killer flick, and he's just like, man, this is like, what is going on? Right
them ballad. Yeah.
It's like next time you watch
give
it,
me the
just
power.
Be like, no, but yeah, I like franchise movies up to a certain point. You know what I mean?
Yeah. No, I feel you. Yeah. I'm just glad you have a better appreciation for Friday now.
No, it happened. Like, I like them. Like, Friday 1, like, I always was like, this is a good movie. But, like, as I went on and heard you guys talk about it more, like, I could see a little bit more detail stuff that I liked.
Right. Nice.
See, I used to think 4 was the best. And then as I got older, I was like, you know what? Great. I think I personally like 5 the best. It's not the best. 2 is probably the best.
Oh, nice. Love it.
I think 2 is probably the best. But
my favorite. Yeah, I love it.
I definitely think 1, 2, 4, and 5 are better. Like, I think if I had to rank them, let's just do like 5 personal favorites. It's like 5, 2, 1, and 4 about the same. And then like 3, then 6.
Yeah.
Then 7. And then I don't give a fuck. I just don't give a fuck after that.
We're very close. Yeah. I mean, I have 2 as my favorite. It would go 2, 1, 4, 3, 5, 6, 7.
Don't give a fuck about
maybe remake in the middle, but either way. Well, that's another show. I'll talk about that. If I'm going to recommend an exploding head show, because everybody always tells me this, that they keep re-listening to the Friday the 13th ritual we did. So I'll pimp that.
Yeah. You guys did a lot of details on that. Well, Brandon was suffering.
Right. I know. 2 Friday fanboys that gave everything for that show.
Just talking about detailed characters that have one line. You're like, yeah, Clarence said this. And it's like, who's Clarence? You don't remember? He's the guy with glasses who's in the bar. And he says, the bartender? No, not the bartender. The bartender's friend who gave him peanuts. No, I don't know who that guy is. Oh, I got
awesome.
Oh, I'll let you go, all right?
Yeah, absolutely. All right, brother.
It's been fun, all right?
Yeah, absolutely. I'll talk to you later, brother. Have a good one.